Welcome to another episode of the Watchlist series. Today we talk about virtual trials offering a lifeline amidst COVID-19. But it's more than just flipping a switch. And so, from TrialSite News, I'm Adrian, and our Watchlist episode starts now. Today we're going to discuss a recent survey that TrialSite correspondent Joseph Constance authored and published recently on TrialSite News concerning virtual clinical trials. COVID-19 has accelerated the move to leverage technology breakthroughs to run studies differently than ever before. But before we deep dive into this, a brief review of the evolution of technologies that helped usher in the age of the virtual clinical trial. So, the pharmaceutical industry has been quick to embrace virtual or decentralized clinical trials during the COVID-19 pandemic, looking to technology to keep the business of running clinical trials as close to schedule as possible. Now, this is not a new concept. In fact, the systems and processes have been headed towards some form of decentralized trial for a lot of years now. With the advent of cloud computing, pervasive web collaboration and communications technology, smartphones, and more recently FDA-validated smartphone apps, a revolution in how clinical trials are conducted was imminent anyway. COVID-19 was the match that lit the gasoline that triggered the virtual trial explosion. Now, virtual clinical trials have a number of shared attributes, but there will always be, for the most part, some physical sites required. The idea here is that in the future, protocols will be written with the patient in mind. The more a study can make the patient's participation easier, the better clinical trial patient enrollment and retention metrics will be. Virtual clinical trials are made possible by the confluence of distinct technology breakthroughs over the past several years. First and foremost, we can start nearly a decade ago, when came the advent of the true cloud computing. Truly disruptive, unprecedented computing power was now possible to drive applications in a far more flexible and scalable manner. For example, trial site principals remember the days when a clinical quality assurance department would not accept an e-clinical application unless it was hosted on-premise in the pharmaceutical company or in a rented data center of the pharma company's choosing. With cloud computing, especially multi-tenancy new applications, were created for businesses that brought enormous economies of scale, as one application could be accessed by many different companies. So this breakthrough led to great efficiency, scalability, and utility. However, the pharma industry still had to overcome the heartburn of having their applications hosted in a new type of environment. But with companies like Veeva, who helped validate multi-tenant applications, helped pave the way for breakthroughs such as virtualization, which were made possible by products such as VMware and later Microsoft's Hyper-V. A whole new way to deliver technology was now available. So this ultimately leads to massive cloud breakthrough, leading to public clouds such as Amazon Web Services, Microsoft Azure, Google, and others where many apps are deployed today. So with this movement well underway, many different key clinical trial applications could be run from cloud-based remote server farms. This was a major breakthrough for the pharmaceutical industry to accept a new form of clinical trial data and document management. Now, in the meantime, another breakthrough that has led to the virtual clinical trials movement has been the smartphone and tablet revolution. Prior to Steve Jobs' incredible advancement with the iPhone, there were older forms of patient data capture for clinical trials, but the concept of bring your own device didn't really exist at that point. But with the advent of the smartphone revolution, now nearly everybody has a very sophisticated computer with them all the time, which of course we call the smartphone. And with this came the next innovation, which were a series of applications for health data collection made possible by brilliant developers and visionary business architects. And so we can fast forward to several years ago, where there are literally hundreds of apps available in the Apple Store and Google Android marketplace that support clinical trials. In fact, there are what we call the GCP FDA validated apps that actually collect and monitor health data. An example of this would be an app used for pain study. In traditional studies, often the patient might have some electronic diary with hardware that the drug company had to give to patients. Now, this was very expensive and not very user-friendly. With today's smartphone apps, however, that allow patients in real time to talk and explain their pain levels to their smartphones in real time and associated with the context of that pain. Now, this level of data collection for a clinical trial is unprecedented and can lead to higher quality data. One example of this, in our recently covered article, thanks to Joseph Constance's work, is Medible, a fascinating Silicon Valley company that is developing an end-to-end mobile platform to manage clinical trials. Now, the next innovation that has shaken up the markets includes telehealth platforms. Although telehealth has been around for a while, it was relatively slow to adopt in the conservative, highly regulated biopharmaceutical clinical trial industry. But due to the need for greater patient centricity, meaning making the trial easier for the patient, companies such as Science 37 raised lots of capital to introduce disruptive telehealth platforms. And then we have another important breakthrough, and that is the recognition that electronic medical records at provider, meaning the site, had tremendous unlocked potential. Startups such as CureFit Clinical Research created turnkey virtual clinical trial offerings by combining cloud-based applications such as Site Master File, electronic data capture, and technology to search and secure de-identified patient data at the site level to conduct more efficient and effective clinical trials via a virtual model. And then there's another important breakthrough in the clinical trial process, which has been the emergence of social media and social networks. Finding patients has always been difficult. For example, only 3% of all eligible cancer patients actually participate in clinical trials. So over the past 5 years, we've seen the power of tapping into and recruiting patients from social media. This activity, accomplished via digital channels, represents yet another capability that has fundamentally transformed the future of clinical trials. Challenges in the way of virtual studies still exist, however, and there are many studies that absolutely require on-site visits. And we can see this in therapeutic areas such as oncology, gene and cell therapy, and therapeutic areas where there may be a need for more site visits. So there will never be a 100% transformation to only virtual clinical trials, but rather there will be far more flexible and tailored offerings based on the nature of the clinical trial protocol. And a key element moving forward is the protocol and how the clinical trial is designed in the first place. And this is important. If the clinical trial protocol is designed in a vacuum, decoupled from how patients will be recruited and accrued, it will be difficult to fully capitalize on the available technologies. The process of actually planning and authoring clinical trial protocols may have to evolve based on all of the emerging and available options for what we call hybrid trials. That is, trials that have some sort of virtual and on-site components. Now, to be clear, pharmaceutical companies and research sites just can't flip a switch to make this happen. But they sure can start revamping their clinical operations to be ready to capitalize on new opportunity, especially in the age of COVID-19. And so on that vein, let's take a closer look at the benefits and risks of virtual clinical trials. And so first, let's touch on the benefits here. Virtual clinical trials offer a number of advantages to sponsors. They quicken recruitment, for example, social networks like Facebook. They expand recruitment opportunities, which in turn expands recruitment geographically. It improves and expands patient engagement, potentially delivers verified data more quickly, runs studies far more efficiently and economically, and support patient centricity, which leads to greater patient retention. However, as mentioned earlier, going virtual won't be as easy as just flipping a switch. Their implementation comes with a number of challenges. The industry has been hesitant because of the concerns around patient care, how to collect needed data in a reliable way, and regulatory requirements. However, trial site principals have also found in the past that pharmaceutical clinical quality assurance departments are overly conservative, and often regulators will support and embrace disruptive technology more than with some of the risk-averse pharma employees. So generally, all virtual and teleplatforms must comply with federal, national, and local regulations as relevant, including those involving patient privacy and, of course, the US FDA and, if in another country, the national regulatory body overseeing clinical research. Then, there is a need to establish virtual trial best practices. And as we mentioned earlier, protocols must incorporate language that takes into account the use of virtual technologies by both patients and staff. And it is important to note that it's not one size fits all here either. Different classes of study may have different virtual trial-friendly profiles. Best practices will emerge based on phase of trial, therapeutic area, type of investigational product, and a number of other factors. So what about the risks? Virtual clinical trials may not be right for every setting. If a clinical trial necessitates a complex measurement, i.e. brain imaging, specialized oncology and cardiovascular procedures, surgeries, so on and so forth, a trip to a clinic will be necessary. Those participating in a trial involving gene and cell therapy probably will be required to go on site for therapy. And there are concerns over the privacy of the data collected. Data collection through an app does create privacy and security risks. Some trials may be hybrid in nature. And then let's talk about de novo protocols. Many operations are geared towards the traditional site-based model and use boilerplate protocols, according to Dr. Jonathan Cotlier, Chief Medical Officer at Science 37, which conducts decentralized trials using an in-house network of telemedicine investigators and home health nurses supported by a fully integrated decentralized clinical trial platform. So Cotlier explained that you have to create a de novo protocol that accommodates telemedicine and changes to the operational order of the trial to accommodate people participating from home. Those could include sending nurses to the home, shipping the investigational product directly to patients instead of dispensing it from a research pharmacy, and taking into consideration local telemedicine laws that may be different from state to state. And then there's new operational concepts. Sometimes the new protocol language required is not overbearing. For example, instead of indicating that a study could take place only in a clinic, the language could be rewritten to include a patient's home. But one may also have to include completely new operational concepts covering electronic devices, data capture, and telemedicine. And these are not insignificant hurdles. They often require more time and more consideration than expected. And so, Cotlier went on to say that in a virtual trial, we'd have the patients go to a local imaging center near their home and have images taken in the same way that they would at pre-qualified imaging centers. But instead of a local radiologist rendering a decision, the raw radiology would be uploaded and sent to the trial's oncologist and radiologist for review. So let's just imagine then for a second. An Uber for clinical trials in the future, where all imaging labs can be notified by an app when a clinical trial needs their service. Touching on this very subject, Allison Holland, head of decentralized trials at Medable, a provider of software and digital solutions for decentralized trials, said that decentralized virtual clinical trials are exciting, and they offer a huge potential to improve how we conduct clinical research on drug development. So, virtual technologies and methodologies have enabled trial sponsors to circumvent impediments. Holland went on to say that it's important to look at a virtual trial from a data flow perspective and determine what could be a digital source of the data, then determine how that can be streamed together, and then make sure that the patients have been given choices about how to participate in a secure way. So, let's bring it all together here. Virtual clinical trials are here to stay. And COVID-19 certainly made this fact a reality. The benefits that many technology vendors and advocates and pharma companies have been calling out for years are finally coming to fruition. Clinical trials can be managed in a far more efficient and effective manner while also ensuring patient centricity, which of course means putting the patient first, making sure they can actually participate in the study while ensuring they are comfortable and that their needs are met. The companies and research institutions that invest in best practices and process reengineering based on how to allocate protocols, processes, and technology to best optimize the various technology options will get ahead here. Those companies that plan intelligently and aggressively to execute will be ahead of those companies that are reactionary. The future is looking very bright for clinical trials. COVID-19 has been an incredibly hard period for us all, and it's not over yet. But the genesis for the transformation of clinical research is well underway, and TrialSite News is proud to be a part of it. Now, on this note, TrialSite News is launching TrialSite Connect, the world's first social network designed exclusively for research. It is a digital tool for research sites to connect and engage with patients or participants, and or to promote their abilities to sponsors and CROs, as an example. This type of offering, it is hoped, will only contribute more value to those doing research. And with that, my friends, we must bring this episode to a close. As always, we appreciate each and every one of you in our audience, and we look forward to seeing you all next time. From TrialSite News, I'm Adrian, and this is the Watchlist series.